The title is on the screen. It's Introduction of Holomorphic Floer Theory, which we proposed more than six years ago. Jointly with Maxim. I hear some echo. I don't know whether it's kind of okay. Now it disappeared. All right. So anyway, I assume that you either heard my talk or you have my slides. So I cut the second part of the slides and edit it a little bit for easier reading. All right, but the first two slides are exactly copy-paste. It's a summary of the first part of my talk. And it concerns exponential integrals, which is a main topic. It's kind of illustration of holomorphic Floer theory and the example of exponential integrals, mostly finite dimensional, but there will be something about infinite dimensions at the end of my talk. So let's recall from the last time that we understand exponential integrals as kind of periods, as integral of exponential differential form, exponent of some function, product with the volume form, integral over some cycle, real cycle of the dimension 1/2 of the real dimension of our space. And so we defined depending on this Planck constant, which is a complex parameter or it's a formal parameter sometimes, we define the collection of homology or other cohomology groups, Betti, the one which contains integration cycles, and the RAM, which contains the differential forms which we integrate. And we define them in two different versions, global, which is natural. If you integrate a global form or global chain or global cycle, and local, it's something which lives near critical points of the function, which actually it's not present. The function is not present on this slide, but it's present. You can look at the expanded version of slides from last time. So there are four isomorphisms, which basically relates local and global versions of this cohomology. For example, like Betti local to global means that the global Betti cohomology, which is defined as certain relative cohomology, it can be expressed as a direct sum over all critical values or critical points if everything if we are in generic position of some local expressions. Okay, so this was this is a slide from the last time, and we categorified there are local and global versions of Foucault categories. This is essential part, the most important part of holomorphic Floer theory, that we deal with objects which are Floer theoretical by their nature, in particular Foucault categories, and they also exist in global and local versions. And there are four isomorphisms, or other equivalences of categories, and the categories also depend on the complex parameter H bar, which appears when we rescale the holomorphic symplectic form. So these four isomorphisms with primes, they are exactly parallel to for isomorphism of cohomology groups on the previous slide. And this is what I discussed at the very last portion of my talk. Part of these categorical equivalences, which just directly implies isomorphisms on the previous slide, part of this 3' is a global Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. Here on the left hand side, this hole with index h bar, it denotes a category of holonomic differential quantization modules, DQ modules, something like D modules, but in the framework of arbitrary complex symplectic manifold. So, and on the left hand side, we have, so this holonomic, it corresponds to the Dirac side. It's something like, for example, if you have a function, you can consider D module, which corresponds to its exponent. And this something which will stay on the left hand side. And on the right hand side, we have, if you'd like, the Betti model. It's a Foucault category. And this is something which, if you'd like, produces this integration cycles on the first slide. Anyway, it's a short reminder from the last time. So today I will be speaking about more kind of precise and concrete illustration of abstract concepts from the last time. And I start with the Betti site. I will remind you what are thimbles. I will assume that my manifold is scalar and the function for which I consider exponential integral, assume that it's Morse. And also I fix Planck constant as a complex number and theta its argument. Then the thimble, it's a Lagrangian submanifold in X. It can be defined in two equivalent ways. Either you take this function, the real part of the rotated F, and look for gradient lines, outcoming of critical points, or you can take the imaginary part of the same function and look for look at it as a Hamiltonian. So this is a picture. This is a thimble in the direction of theta, outcoming of the critical point xi, and zi is a corresponding critical value. So the projection of thimble is a ray outcoming from the critical value in the direction of theta. And in order to define the exponential integral, we need to choose a holomorphic volume form. Let's do it. And let's assume that the Planck constant, which I treat now as a complex number, it does not belong to the Stokes ray. Now, if you look, well, if I will be able you to make look, no, I cannot. On the previous slide, no, I can. So there are Stokes rays when two critical values belong to the same ray outcoming of zero. And let's assume that H bar does not belong to such a ray. And then for each critical point or critical value, now it doesn't matter, we define the model integral I with the same index I small, with just the integral of this exponential differential form or the thimble. So thimbles form a basis. So that's the main idea, basis in Betti homology or dually they correspond to the bases in Betti-Koch homology. So we should have a sort of a collection of exponential integrals, and every other integral or any other cycle should be a linear combination, integer linear combination of this one. All right, now if I have a collection of critical values, this Zi, so I will assume just for simplicity that they are in generic position, which means that there are no straight line which contains at least 3 points. 2 is okay, but not 3. And so if there are 2 points on the same Stokes ray, then we can order them. Say that I is smaller than j if the I is closer to the origin than the j. Okay. Then the part which I mentioned last time in the framework of holomorphic Floer theory, how it appears, it's a wall crossing phenomenon, which now can be kind of, it's very simple. We have integrals and we can look on what happens if we change the parameter h bar in such a way that it crosses the Stokes ray, which contains Sij, it contains, by our assumptions, precisely 2 critical values. Then the integral changes by the famous formula. The integer coefficient Nij can be interpreted in 2 different ways, but actually in many different ways, but at least in 2 very intuitive ways. One, it's a number of gradient trajectories of this real valued function, and which join critical points xi and xj. Now, because we are in holomorphic situation, different critical points of the Morse function, they have the same Morse index equal to the dimension, complex dimension. So generically, there are no gradient lines which join xi and xj, but Stokes ray is exception, and that's why we can this Nij makes sense when h bar belongs to the Stokes ray. So if you'd like, this is a wall crossing formula for these basic integrals. I prefer to write it in a little bit different way. And if you remember Maxim Stokes on probably, I don't remember either his first talk on linear resurgence or his second talk on analyticity in quantum field theory, you should remember these formulas if you never saw them before. So anyway, let's modify the exponential integral in this way. Obviously, the factor should come from the stationary phase expansion. And now as h bar goes to zero, this modified exponential integral gives us a formal series in h bar, which as we should expect, it should be resurgent. And I explain you why it should be like that from more general theory. But in any case, the jump of this modified exponential integral is given by this formula. It's another way to write down the wall crossing using the same integer coefficients Nij. And now we can reformulate all that as a certain Riemann-Hilbert problem, or rather as a solution. I would like to say that this collection of modified exponential integrals, it's a solution of certain Riemann-Hilbert problem on the complex line or complex plane. It depends whether which terminology do you like. So we have a bunch of Stokes rays there, and we know the jumps of our functions along these rays. So this slide contains the abstract description of this Riemann-Hilbert problem. So if we combine all these integrals into one vector, so we have a bunch of functions which value in a vector space, CK, K is a rank of Betti cohomology, which in our case, it's just a cardinality. It's a number of critical values or critical points. So we assume that we are in generic position. So we are looking for holomorphic functions on C star minus the union of Stokes rays, such that when we cross the Stokes ray Sij, then those functions obey the following jumping formulas. So Cj doesn't change and Ci changed by this. If you'd like, it's all this is just a version of Picard-Lefschetz formula in this particular case. Now, if we have a solution, and we do, because we have exponential integrals, then they give a section of a certain holomorphic vector bundle. First, it's a holomorphic vector bundle on C star, but in fact, it can be extended to the whole complex line C. And C, I recall you, C is a coordinate, it's a complex line with a coordinate H bar. So basically, we started with exponential integrals. In each Stokes sector, we consider their formal expansions. So they're just formal series. Now, when over each Stokes ray, we modified this divergent formal series. And as a result, we obtain holomorphic sections of a holomorphic bundle. So that's kind of a basic data, which as we proposed in this paper, it's last year paper, joint with Maxim, we proposed this data as a general kind of we axiomatize them in the form of what we called analytic wall crossing structures. And we formulated the general conjecture that if we have what we called analytic wall crossing structure, then it gives rise to a resurgent series. And basically the idea is exactly like we saw in the case of exponential integrals. If we have something which is called analytic wall crossing structure, which I review on the next couple of slides, then we can on the, we have a bunch of Stokes rays on the complex plane. We have formal series in general divergent in each Stokes sector, something bounded by Stokes rays. And we use this wall crossing structure to modify the trivial bundle on the union of these sectors in such a way that we obtain a holomorphic bundle. So then the section of this holomorphic bundle in the Stokes sector, it has the same formal expansion as our formal series, because these wall crossing formulas, if you look at them, they have exponentially small factors. They do not affect Taylor series. But since the section is holomorphic, then this holomorphicity is responsible for the resurgent property of the initial divergent series. This is a rough idea. Now, from the point of view of holomorphic Floyer theory, Stokes rays, they appear when, for example, in the case of exponential integrals, we have h bar such that for the rescaled symplectic form, there are non-trivial pseudo-holomorphic disks with a boundary on the zero section, on the zero section, which is L0, and on the graph, of the differential. So we have two holomorphic Lagrangian submanifolds. And in general, there are no pseudo-holomorphic disks, as I explained last time, with a boundary on these two Lagrangians. But when they appear, it's exactly when H bar belongs to the Stokes ray. And therefore, this wall crossing, these numbers Nij, they in fact, it's a virtual number of pseudo-holomorphic disks with the boundaries on two a given complex Lagrangian submanifolds. Okay, now, as I told you, this abstractly can be described in terms of analytic stability data or analytic wall crossing structures, which is a little bit more general structure. And so on the next slides, I will review this formalism. First, stability data. It turns out to be very useful. A formalism, which actually we invented in 2008 for very technical purpose. We proposed a theory of generalized Donaldson Thomas invariants. And although the whole thing was rather categorical, there was a piece of this general theory which did not depend on the category, but which captured the wall crossing phenomenon. And this is what we called a stability data on graded Lie algebras. And it turns out that it's a good language, and this structure appears again and again in very different topics, for example, in complex integrable systems or in mirror symmetry. All right, so I briefly recall what is a stability data, what data defines the stability data. So first we should have a free abelian group of a finite rank, which is in physics language, it's a charge lattice. It's gamma isomorphic Z in the power N. And we should have a gamma graded Lie algebra G, say over any field of characteristic zero, say over Q. So then in that paper of 2008, we spoke about stability data on the graded Lie algebra. So we assume that our problem, whatever is it, it is, it gives us a graded Lie algebra, and we define stability data on that graded Lie algebra. And these stability data are determined by two things, which are 3 and 4. First, the homomorphism of abelian groups of this charge lattice to complex numbers. And following physicists, we call it the central charge of the stability data. And the most important, it's a collection of elements, A of gamma, such that A of gamma belongs to the corresponding graded component, G of gamma. And this A of gamma, they encode enumerative invariants of my problem. It's not exactly Donaldson Thomas invariants, if you know that story, but they're related to Donaldson Thomas invariants by a simple platistic transformation. So anyway, stability data on the graded Lie algebra, it's just this 3 and 4. And these data are required to satisfy just one axiom, which we call the support property, which is very important, but I don't want to review it. Roughly speaking, it says that if we consider all gammas for which A of gamma is not equal to zero, support of this collection, then this support should be sufficiently far, it should be separated from the kernel of Z, which means that if Z of gamma is equal to zero, then this A of gamma cannot be non-trivial. So if you'd like, Donaldson-Thomas invariant is non-trivial for the charge which does not belong to the kernel of Z. All right, so this is sort of a formal definition. And in our last year paper on analytic stability structures, analytic stability data, we consider just one particular graded Lie algebra. It's a graded Lie algebra of vector fields on the torus T gamma, which is associated with the charge lattice. For some reasons, this is sort of most important. For example, for Donaldson-Thomas theory, one considered a subalgebra of this Lie algebra. In Donaldson-Thomas theory, gamma carries a skew symmetric integer form. And so T gamma carries a Poisson structure, and we consider the Lie subalgebra of this one, of vector gamma, Lie subalgebra of Hamiltonian vector fields. So in some sense, this is the most important example. And we proved that in this case, the stability data on this particular graded Lie algebra can be restated pure geometrically in terms of certain formal scheme. So this is a reference. I don't have time to review it. It was done in our paper of 2013 on wall crossing structures and integrable systems. So what we take as a black box, then stability data on this graded Lie algebra of vector fields, it's the same as certain formal scheme. But formal scheme sometimes can come from analytic space. It's a formalization of an analytic space. And in this case, we call the stability data analytic. Of course, there are many more direct reformulations of this property, which can be found in our last year paper in the archive. Now, having analytic stability data and using the C-star action on the central charge, we can construct an analytic fiber bundle over C-star with the coordinate H-bar, exactly as we did in the case of exponential integrals. So it's exactly the same philosophy. We have a bunch of trivial bundles outside of the projection of walls. There are walls in that story where two charges are projected to the same real line. And so we have trivial bundles or Stokes sectors bounded by this projection of walls by Stokes rays. And we modify them over the Stokes rays by automorphisms, which depend, Stokes automorphisms, which depend on this collection A of gamma. If you'd like, they give rise to Stokes automorphisms. And this, from this oversimplified point of view, this
probably only.
Huh? Yep. Question? No? All right, so let me continue. So this is an example. So I revisit the example of exponential integrals for Morse function f. Now my gamma is z in the power k. K is the number of critical values or critical points. So there is a standard basis in gamma, which I denote by EI, and my central charge map the basis vector in ZI. Now, the Stokes automorphism, so these Nijs, these are, these are, if you'd like, my A of gammas. And the Stokes automorphisms, the gluing automorphisms, they are written here in the standard coordinate on the torus T gamma associated on the torus of characters of this lattice. So this, if you'd like, this kind of a cluster type transformation. All right, and so that's exactly, this is abstract way to reformulate this Riemann-Hilbert problem, which I discussed previously. And so this kind of our general conjecture, which says that if you have analytic wall crossing, analytic stability data, then we have resurgence of the corresponding formal series, it explains the known fact that the formal expansion of modified exponential integral, so it is resurgent. Okay, so I mentioned just kind of, I mentioned two possible generalizations of previous theory. There are more of them. First, I can consider a family of functions instead of just one function. This is an example, U is a parameter. And then instead of analytic stability data, we have analytic wall crossing structure, which roughly speaking is a family of stability data parameterized by the, some parameter space. A less trivial example, when we replace the exact form df by an arbitrary closed one form. And then we have the parallel story, but it's more difficult because the form alpha can have non-trivial periods. From the point of view of holomorphic Floyer theory, we still have two complex Lagrangians, which is a zero section in the Cartesian bundle and the graph of the differential. But for example, if we look at this particular holomorphic one form, then as a periods, we have something which we didn't see before. We can, for example, see as an exponential integral, the gamma function up to some factors. This is the bottom line of this slide. And we can prove, again, constructing the analytic stability data, we still can claim that the corresponding formal power series is resurgent in the case of one form. All right, and the last part of my talk, it's something about infinite dimensional, like Feynman integrals, and I will be very brief here. So the idea is the following, that originally, actually, more of the Floyer complex, it came from infinite dimensional exponential integral, from infinite dimensional action function. But we know that there are kind of two ways we can think that that Feynman integrals gives us some amplitudes, and we can invert the logic and in order to study, for example, resurgent properties of perturbative expansions, we can look at their finite dimensional modules and these quantized Hamiltonians, wave functions and all that, and use finite dimensional techniques, in particular analytic wall crossing structure, in order to prove that the formal expansions are resurgent. And this is a remark for those who do not like this inversion of nature logic and want to manipulate with infinite dimensional integrals, it's very interesting. But mathematically, it's more difficult because you should give a meaning, for example, of Bethe cohomology. You should consider semi-infinite cycles in infinite dimensional vector spaces. So mathematically, it's a more difficult story. And if you'd like to define the wall crossing structure, you should count virtual number of solutions to nonlinear equations. And so it's kind of, it's very interesting, but that's not the point which I would like to advocate today. So I start with a classical story. So I have, it's quite general. It doesn't have to be the cotangent bundle, just a complex manifold, two complex Lagrangian submanifolds. And I consider this P, the space of paths with endpoints on these Lagrangians. So the Lagrangians are holomorphic, symplectic manifold is holomorphic, but the paths are real. So on this infinite dimensional manifold, we have a closed one form, which is written here. And basically I integrate my holomorphic form over certain two-dimensional cycle. Yeah. Now, zeros of this, form is closed. It's a closed one form and it's a holomorphic closed one form. And zeros are just constant paths, which correspond to the intersection points of these two Lagrangians. It's exactly something which we saw in when we defined the Foucault category. Homes between L0 and L1 was generated by intersection points. And they're interpreted here as zeros of certain closed one form. All right, now, if we look formally at the path integral, we can think of it as a certain limit, like chronological exponent or whatever. So we divided the path into the collection in the finite number of, we put marked points, like times, and we think of this infinite dimensional exponential integral as a limit. And this limit, it contains not only kind of boundary conditions, Psi0 and Psi n, but also some intermediate points. And so what we suggest is some axiomatics, if you'd like, some formalism to think about this data. What is it? This Psi0 and Psi n, of course, the notation suggests that they should correspond to some wave functions corresponding to L0 and L1. Classically, they are sections of the square root of the canonical bundles. But when we go to the bulk, when we move inside, when the point Ti is not zero, T0 or Tn, we are, it's some intermediate point on the interval. And so this should be thought of an element of the quantized algebra of functions. What we see here, yeah, this should correspond to something associated with my boundary conditions with L0 and L1. And all these intermediate things should be elements, if you'd like, of quantized algebra of functions. And we should also, this most important thing, should encode the integration cycle. And this is what we propose. So I will explain it in the case of a trivial Hamiltonian. It's exactly what Fleur considered himself, kind of the simplest case. It's in, the action is integral of PDQ. It's an integral of the symplectic form itself. All right, so what are the data? Again, there are two types of data, as it should be an exponential integral. So there should be Derham type of data and Betti type of data. The Derham type of data, it's an element mu of this group. Now, what is E0 Derham and E1 Derham? These are holonomic DQ modules. This one corresponds to L0, to one of given complex Lagrangians. And this one corresponds to another one. In the category of holonomic DQ modules, we can compute Holm between these two things. And the choice of the integration form, the volume form, corresponds to the choice of an element mu from x to n, n is a complex dimension of the symplectic manifold. This is one choice. And the integration cycle should be an element of x0. Now on the Betti, I treat the same L0 and L1 as objects on the Foucault category. And I should choose gamma, which belongs to x0 of the local Foucault category. I choose for each intersection point, I have a local Foucault category, and as I defined last time. And then second part of the data, the choice of a cycle, is encoded in the choice of this gamma. All right, now my formal expansion associated with a particular intersection of points. It's sort of a local in nature, this formal integral. It's a pairing between two things. I apply our generalized Riemann-Hilbert functor to the Derham. I arrive to the Foucault category, as we explained, as I explained last time. Foucault category is a Calabi-Yau category. There is a Calabi-Yau pairing in it. And this is this pairing with black dots. And then I pair whatever I got with a given, with a chosen element gamma, with an integration cycle. So this is, in this axiomatic, this is a formal integral, exponential integral. And you can check in examples, and this is indeed the case. But if we want to go from formal expansions to analytic functions, then we should apply Stokes automorphisms. And for that, we should study pseudo-holomorphic disks with a boundary on L0 and L1 for some special values of h-bar. And here, the second part of this slide, in the special case of the cotangent bundle and our old friends L0 and L1, I am explaining that what we saw in the definition of these local exponential integrals, integrals over Betti, local Betti symbols, local symbols outcoming of critical points, they indeed correspond to those abstract data which we saw on the previous slide. In particular, x0 consists, it's generated by local symbols associated with critical points. So I can take any integer combination of them as an integration cycle. And similarly, xn, so my zero section is x. So the corresponding DQ module is just a quantized algebra of functions. And so this is a twisted Derham cohomology from my last lecture. And indeed the pairing between Derham and Betti, it's exponential integral, as I explained last time in detail. So this formalism fits at least in this simplest example. Now, from this I already told you that we consider the simplest action PDQ, yeah, which means that there is no dynamics, H is equal to zero, and then we define the left-hand side, which is still ill-defined, no matter whether a Hamiltonian is trivial or not, we define it as a pairing between wave functions which correspond to L0 and L1. Now, if H bar is non-trivial, then we should use this additional family of time-dependent Hamiltonians to transport the wave function corresponding to L0 to L1. And this is a kind of, it requires some modification of the formalism of the axiomatics, which I presented a couple of slides ago, but it's possible to do. And that's what actually we did in, well, it's not published, but yeah, there is a formalism of quantum wave functions and their quantum transport. You can think about a transport of WKB expansion. So we use, of course, some Hamiltonian floor corresponding to this time-dependent Hamiltonian. And so when it's done, then we can consider the left-hand side, this integral of the local Lefschetz thimble in infinite dimensions. I don't know, like in Chern-Simons theory, whatever. And then modulo some renormalization, which is necessary to do in infinite dimensions. We have a series, formal series in H bar. And using the formalism of analytic stability data or analytic wall crossing structure, we can establish the resurgence of this formal expansion by finite dimensional techniques. I believe that in Maxim's second talk on analyticity in quantum field theory, he gave plenty of examples to this formalism. And actually, this is it. It's the second part of my talk, so it should be shorter than the first one. Okay, thank you. So since it's a self-service today, I should ask, are there any questions? Typically, the host should have some couple of general questions, so then at least so the speaker will know that at least one person listened. So since today is a self-service, okay, please.
So the Riemann-Hilbert problem that you showed, is that the same as Bridgeland's Riemann-Hilbert problem that he talks about?
I don't know what Bridgeland is talking about, so I'm sorry, because it's obvious there is a Riemann-Hilbert problem about which we kind of, I mean, it's obvious. You don't have to be Bridgeland to invent it. You have something with jumps, and you know the jumps, so you have a Riemann-Hilbert problem. So I think Riemann and Hilbert spoke about it. Yeah. So, and the structure which appears, as, maybe this is kind of important to stress. We have what we call analytic stability data or wall crossing structure, and it can be of different types. It can be analytic. Then we can construct a holomorphic vector bundle on the complex line. And so we have resurgence of formal expansions of these sections. It can be algebraic, And this is another story. If the wall crossing structure is algebraic, of course it's analytic, but it's much more delicate property. And this algebraicity is responsible for algebraicity of Donaldson Thomas series. And it's all the same formalism, you know. So that's, I believe that the formalism of wall crossing structure is an adequate language for whatever you see in Donaldson Thomas series. Yeah.
Thank you.
I might have another question.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, about those applications to infinite dimensional integrals. So I look at the very last formula in on this slide, and yeah. So the coefficients in this power series, right?
It's coefficients, it's just Feynman rules, it's nothing more.
Does it follow from your definition that they are given by Feynman rules?
No, I don't think so. I mean, it's a question about physics. It's a question whether, you see this, when we define the left-hand side as certain matrix element of the transported Hamiltonian, yeah? So that's a question whether indeed the Feynman integral, when it's kind of expanded, coincide with the expansion in H bar of this matrix coefficient. Well, if you believe in that, then yes. But the justification of whether the Hamiltonian formalism and Lagrangian formalism gives you the same answer, it's not a part of our axiomatics. Rather, what we did, we axiomatized or formalized this expression in terms of holomorphic Floyer theory. Yeah, this C prime, this matrix coefficient. So we give a meaning to it. And we propose how to prove, if you'd like, that the corresponding formal series are resurgent. So again, it's not a theorem, it's conjecture, our resurgence conjecture, but it seems to be, it covers all known, at least to me, examples of resurgence, like a Kalvaronian theory, very far from quantum field theory. So we can deal with this Hamiltonian approach. Now, whether it coincides with something which physicists do formally, it's a different question now. It's not related to my formalism. The hope, if you believe in that, yes, then you can prove. Yeah. Okay. More questions? Okay, if there are no more questions, as a host, I should say, let's thank the speaker again. And so this is the end of my talk. Thank you very much.